There's a special kind of pride that you feel deep down inside, a strength that seems to thrive in Lima Island County.
The American way of life, to get in gear and do what's right.
An unbreakable forthright link called Real American Strength, Lima Island County. Real American Strength.
Keeping you up to date with what's happening in your community. Community Focus on GTV2.
Thanks for joining us today on Community Focus. I'm Ann Decker. In the studio with me today is Jill Ackerman. She's the superintendent of the Lima City Schools, and we've settled in to the beginning of the year, and now we're working on concerts already.
So October kicks off our season, and it will be quite busy this year. We are going to start actually October the 8th, which is a Tuesday night, at 7 o'clock with the Liberty Arts, with the orchestra and the choir, 5th and 6th grade, at the Lima Senior High Auditorium. So it's a very big venue, plenty of seating, so we like to encourage people that just want to get out for a nice evening of music at no cost to come and join us.
You can't beat that.
There's going to be band, orchestra, and choirs perform, and they're going to demonstrate and discuss some of their techniques and show how they warm up and everything, because this is really the starting point, which then leads to, on the 10th at 7:30, the first choir concert at Lima Senior High School. So this will be sort of a preview to the pieces that will be happening throughout the school year. It's an autumn sampler is what we call it. And that will happen at 7:30 on Thursday, October the 10th. Then, in a couple of weeks after that, or the 17th actually, just 1 week after that, the Lima Senior High Concert, Jazz, and Symphonic Band will perform at the high school at 7:30 p.m. And that first concert out of the gate is always really exciting for the students and a great chance to hear where those groups are starting from. Now, the band has obviously been performing a lot in the fair and at the games and things like that, but when you put them together into concerts and they actually play overtures and folklores and different kinds of music, and it's really exciting. So we're hoping to have a good crowd come out for that as well.
And that's free if people just want to show up?
It is free. We are always happy to accept donations, but it is free of charge. And there's plenty of seating, and it's a great auditorium, and the sound is really nice too. Then what we do have coming is a culmination of a project that started back in the 2009-2010 school year with Mike Huffman at the Arts Magnet, and it was with a group of eighth graders, and it just sort of morphed into a great big project that we have titled Racism, Prejudice, Tolerance, and Acceptance. It is going to premiere on November the 8th, Friday, November the 8th at 7 o'clock at Art Space. And this was a year-long unit of study that these children did at the time, who are now seniors. They started to talk about prejudices, and then they went out into the community and they interviewed people within our community who have experienced prejudices within their lifetime. And they talked about tolerance and acceptance, and then they did oral reports on, or readings on, the interviews that they had. And then from that, they created and exhibited poster-like community-produced works of art expressing their personal opinions about the social issues that they experienced during that unit of study. So if you come into our Ed Center hallway in South, you can see some of those large works that they created, some of their posters. This exhibit sort of is part of that common threads notion that we've done for so long, that the arts can be an agent for change in the process of education for both social and political change. Now, Mike Huffman and some local artists sort of took off and went even deeper with it, which has thus led to this final product and this opening on Friday, November the 8th. So we're really excited about that. The Foundation for the Arts in town and Marty McDonald has been very supportive, both with space at Art Space and just really rallying around us to help us to get this off the ground It's a multimedia installation, and it's going to be very exciting.
What can we expect besides the posters?
Well, I think that you can expect some of the students that did the work to be there to talk about their experiences, and we're hoping that possibly some of the adults that they interviewed within the community to be there as well to talk about their experiences. So there will be a lot of discussion, and just, you know, able to talk with those students about what they learned from it. And it actually just started from sort of an off-collar joke, I think, that someone told, and then it went into this whole big conversation of, you know, just a typical everyday joke really has some prejudice overtones to it. And
most
then that's where it went. It was a teachable moment that turned into an entire year's worth of study. So
that's impressive and commendable.
Very exciting. Yes. And it can be a tough topic to go after, but we felt that it was very important for our students to really get out there and see. There's a wide range of people within our community from all cultural aspects that have had some discussion with our kids about their experiences.
And this opens November 8th?
It opens on Friday, November the 8th at 7 o'clock at Art Space. And then it will be there, so if you can't come for the opening, though, the works will be there through December 21st.
Well, and like for those of us who work downtown, what a great opportunity to walk to the square, have lunch at one of the many restaurants,
right,
and check out the exhibit.
Just walk through and take a look at it.
Which is free, by the way.
Exactly. So I think it's really exciting for our kids.
It is. What a great opportunity.
Yes.
Anything else we need to know about?
Well, what will happen then is once November hits, then we'll start getting into holiday time. So everybody needs to think about, you know, the really wonderful holiday show that our high school students
right.
put on. And that stuff will be coming around the corner. It will be here so fast. So we want everybody to always check our website and like us on Facebook, because we do have a calendar of events up there as well.
Well, and it isn't just the big high school stuff that we've been talking about, but all the elementary schools have concerts and the middle schools. Everybody's got something going on over the next couple months.
Everybody does. So if it's a rainy, chilly evening and you're looking for something to do, you can hop on our website and look for an event to attend. If it's not a concert, it's certainly going to be a sporting event that you can get out to and just enjoy the evening.
Great. And your website again is?
www.limacityschools.org. You can like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter.
Wonderful. Thanks for coming in today.
Thank you for having me.
You're welcome. Jill Ackerman from the Lima City Schools. When we come back, we'll tell you how you can get some help with your energy bills right after this on GTV2.
Reduce, recycle, reuse. Allied Waste Services and the City of Lima encourage you to live green by recycling all that you can. Recycling promotes green living by reducing the amount of waste materials buried in landfills. This saves money, natural resources, and energy. Keep our environment healthy and start recycling today. Allied Waste Services is committed to a clean environment. Contact us today for your recycling needs. Visit our website, republicservicesohio.com, to learn more about recycling today. Do you know what to do when you hear the community warning sirens? The sirens are activated anytime the public is in life-threatening danger. This can be from weather emergencies, chemical releases, or other situations. When you hear the sirens, go inside and turn on your radio or television for more information. Follow the instructions carefully and stay inside until the danger has passed. Remember, the sirens mean to go inside and listen to your radio or television for more information. Take the necessary steps to keep you and your family safe.
Lima City Council has recently amended the city's vicious dog ordinance to deal with potential problems concerning dangerous dogs in the public.
The ordinance is comprehensive. However, here are some key elements that all dog owners and their neighbors should be aware of.
Any dog that is considered a breed of pit bull is considered a vicious dog regardless of its temperament.
A vicious dog is any dog that attacks, bites, or causes injury to a person or domestic animal with or without provocation.
Not under control of the owner, and secure with a muzzle and a leash of 6 feet or less in length, all vicious dogs must be confined when outside in a pen with a secured top and bottom, or with the sides of the pen embedded at least 1 foot deep into the ground.
If you're a dog owner and have concerns about any dogs in your neighborhood, visit LimaPoliceDepartment.com to find out more about the city's vicious dog ordinance.
The fine for noncompliance is $150 per citation, and ignorance of the law is not a defense.
If there's an emergency situation, call local law enforcement for immediate assistance.
Welcome back to Community Focus. I'm Ann Decker, and Marva Cowan is in the studio with us today. She is with the Lima Allen Council on Community Affairs, and the Winter Crisis Program begins on November 1st. But ahead of that, next week, we have the Winter Reconnect program already beginning.
That is correct, Anne. And what the Winter Reconnect order does, it allows any utility customer regulated, AEP, Dominion, it allows them to pay $175 to either get out of disconnect status or to get their services restored. Now, if the person is low income, they could possibly call to make an appointment for winter crisis, because on the 14th, we're also going to start scheduling appointments.
Busy woman.
Yes, but we're going to schedule the appointments through the IVR line. And that number's 1-855-286-7559.
Okay.
And there will be designated hours that an operator will be available to talk to LACCA customers, because they're taking appointments from agencies all across the state. Our hours are 11 o'clock, and it will be 1 o'clock. So people can call to make an appointment on that line 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, so the line doesn't have to be flooded at 8 o'clock in the morning.
Now, if they do want the Winter Reconnect order, do they need to do that through you?
They do not.
Oh, good.
So that's the beauty of it. Because some folks aren't eligible for the HEAP program. They just need to call the utility company and say, I'd like to invoke the Winter Reconnect order.
And that's for any income level, period, no matter who they are.
That is correct. It doesn't make any difference what your income is. If you have a disconnect on your bill and it's more than $175, you just need to pay $175 starting October 14th. And then the utility company will let you set up a payment plan, one-third, one-sixth, one-ninth.
Okay.
And just for the record, probably the customer should ask for the one-ninth plan, because it spreads what's left over into 9 payments instead of 3.
And that makes it a little easier to fit into the budget.
Absolutely.
Now, for those who are low income, who are interested in the Winter Crisis Program, who is eligible for that?
Anybody that is 200% of poverty or below. There are a lot of people that are eligible and they don't realize they're eligible. For instance, a single person can make $5,585 over a 3-month period and be eligible. A family of 4 can make $11,525 over a 3-month period and be eligible. So there are a lot of people that are eligible that are not taking advantage of the program, and they should.
What can the program do for them?
What the program can do is get them out of disconnect or get them restored. The customer can sign up for PIP, and of course that's a different income level. It's $150. Now, with the state HEAP application, customers can now re-verify their PIP or sign up for PIP without having to come to the agency. So they really are trying to figure out ways, as well as LACCA, to become more customer-driven and make it easier for the customers and their work schedules.
You know, we've been throwing around a lot of numbers and letters here, and I know it makes my head spin, and I can just imagine what it's doing to the viewers.
Sure.
But I mean, if there is somebody out there who's low income and can't afford their utility bills this winter, they can just call you and find out if they're eligible, right?
Exactly. They can call our main number, and we can give them any basic information. But to schedule an appointment, they have to call the IVR line.
And again, that is
1-855-286-7559, and that number is toll-free.
All right. Is there anything else you want folks to know?
Make sure when they're calling and scheduling their appointment, they have a pen with them so that they can write down their confirmation number. Make sure that they're entering the correct account number, because that's the number that the IVR sends to the utility company for a hold on their account. And incidentally, IVR stands for Interactive Voice Response. So for the customers out there. And we're just asking that they bring in all of the required documentation, because if they don't have it, we can't process them at the time of application.
All right. Well, it's certainly a wonderful program, and you know, you serve a lot of people.
We do. Last year, we served over 1,400 households in Allen County.
That's incredible.
It is. And so we anticipate that perhaps we will do more this winter.
Okay.
So, and I just want to say this, because anytime that I can, I do. Customers who are on the percentage of income payment plan, PIP Plus, please make your PIP payments. Because if you make your PIP payments, you don't have to worry about disconnect or anything. You will be in good standing with the company and actually get some credit on your arrears.
Wonderful.
Yes.
Good advice.
Yes.
Thank you for coming in today.
Thank you for having
You're
me.
You're welcome. Marva Cowan with LACCA. I'm Ann Decker, and this is Community Focus on GTV2.
I didn't want to be touched. He said it would feel good, but it didn't. So he gave me a new doll and some candy. He told me not to tell anybody and that it's our special secret. How do I make him stop?
Say no. Run away. Scream. It's okay to tell an adult you trust if someone is hurting you or making you uncomfortable. Feel safe. Feel strong. Feel free.
A message from the Allen County Chiefs Association.
With the recent rise in juvenile crime, all Allen County police agencies are stepping up our efforts to reduce this with the enforcement of curfew laws.
This affects anyone under the age of 18. Local laws may vary in age and time requirements among the villages, townships, and cities in the county, so please help us in our efforts by becoming familiar with the curfew law.
Please check the websites on your screen for specific curfew information. Together we can make Lima Allen County a safer place in which to live and work.
Help keep the youth of Lima safe by donating to Lima Safety City today. Hello, I'm Chuck Eichelberger from the Lima Noon Optimist Club. Safety City is a very important part of the Lima community. The Optimist Club is renovating Safety City and it needs your help. Donations can be made by going to the website limasafetycity.org. You can also send a donation to Lima Noon Optimist Club, P.O. Box 428, Lima, Ohio 45802. Help keep the youth of Lima safe by donating to Safety City today.
Let's all do our part to keep the Ottawa River clean and healthy. Clean trash and debris from storm drains to keep them from being washed into the river. Your actions matter.
We're back on Community Focus. I'm Ann Decker, and Howard Elstro is in the studio. Good morning. Howard is Lima's Public Works Director, and we are today talking about the exciting topic of stormwater.
Well, we are.
And you tell me it goes back to the Clean Water Act of 1972?
It does. You know, those of us who were in high school at the time can remember stories about our environment here in America being so polluted that the Cuyahoga River actually caught on fire.
I've heard stories about the Ottawa River catching on fire, too.
And that was about the last straw for America. At that time, the legislatures came together and passed what they called the Clean Water Act of 1972. They knew our nation was going a direction that if it was left unchecked and unimpeded, would befoul the waters of America to a point where it just wouldn't be livable anymore. And I think it was probably a good law when it was passed, but now it's coming to a level where cities and counties and villages must pay more and more attention to it. And that's really what moved us into a stormwater utility being established in the city of Lima about 2 years ago. We are now into the second year of our stormwater utility. And what this is a formalized program that addresses the dictates of the Clean Water Act of 1972 so that the city will be in compliance. They call for public education, public participation. They want to make sure that we watch our community and our businesses for illicit discharge, and we detect those things, and we control illicit discharges, that we control post-construction runoff, and also public erosion control, as well as lay a plan to control pollution and do what they call good housekeeping practices. The stormwater utility in Lima, we property owners all pay a small fee each year through our tax assessments. And that money goes to, first of all, good housekeeping, which means street sweeping, which means understanding our sewer systems, making sure that the stormwater sewer is functional, making sure the pollutants stay out of our stormwater. And why is that important? Because our stormwater system feeds where?
The Ottawa River.
Into the Ottawa River. And the Ottawa River flows into?
The reservoirs.
Well, we take our drinking water out of it, but also everybody else north of us takes their drinking water out of it because the Ottawa River flows into the Great Lakes. So what we dump in our streams affects the next guy down the stream and affects the Great Lakes and eventually flows into our oceans. And we just need to keep our rivers cleaner than we have been in the past. You know, the Stormwater Act precipitated this because of a problem. It originally focused on industries, by and large, and checked that abuse first. Then the EPA has moved into large cities. Now the EPA is turning its attention to medium-sized cities like Lima. And the next step, we understand, is the EPA will turn its attention to smaller communities, county forms of government, villages, and other unincorporated area. And quite frankly, the public dialogue probably needs to address much of that. We, the community of Lima, about 36,000-38,000 people, certainly understand our obligations, and our sanitary discharges are treated before it is dumped into the Ottawa. And quite frankly, the effluent that comes off of our wastewater plant is very clean, cleaner than the water that we are discharging to. And now we are keeping our stormwater system, making sure it is not an impedance to that cleanliness. The question, though, I think that is going to demand public discussion is what are the obligations going to be at the county level and the village level and the township levels and what we call non-point pollution. All of that pollution that when it rains flows into our rivers from agricultural use. You know, you think about some of these mega farms with chickens, hogs, or the dairy and beef industry, and you know, those probably produce as much waste, if not more, than some villages. So the question is, how is that treated? How does that stay out of our streams and rivers? Also in the agricultural field, it's just a fact that to sustain ourselves in this country, our farmers must use the best application of fertilizers and growing techniques that they know. And the question is, when you overuse those, how is that impacting our environment? So I think we're going to see a move from the EPA now that they have addressed cities our size to get into that question of township, villages, and the non-point pollutants, and what kind of controls will be forthcoming in that regard. It still remains to be seen.
Well, you talk about fertilizer on a large scale like the mega farms, but does that break down to the average homeowner, and what can he be doing to ensure that his impact on the land is not making it into the river?
Well, I think that's a good question, and certainly the companies that make fertilizer understand that phosphates have been a long plague on our environment. And you know, if you go through any of the suppliers, the Havens, the Lowe's, the Menards, and look for fertilizer. These days you find phosphate-free fertilizers. But people need to be careful about that because any over-application does run into our stormwater systems, into our rivers, and into our lakes. Back to the City of Lima's commitment, we are continuing to not only improve the quality of our stormwater before it hits the river by keeping pollutants out. So we have really enhanced the street sweeping schedule, making sure that people understand don't throw things in the street, don't blow your grass into the street. All that introduces nutrients which break down and cause problems in the environment. So part of our funding is going to operation and maintenance of our stormwater and systems. Part of it also has created a funding stream to improve our stormwater system so it doesn't adversely affect property and business. And examples of that are probably the construction projects that we've accomplished the last 2 years with the funds that we've been collecting. In 2012, we had about a dozen sites where we had breakdowns in sewers or neighborhoods or properties that continually flooded because of insufficient infrastructure. This past year, 2013, we are just now finishing up about 13 projects to do the same. So residents have seen the expansion of stormwater systems. We have addressed individuals and businesses who said, you know, I have a problem with when it rains, we just have too much water here and it sits and it causes problems. And part of our funding stream has gone to not only improve the quality of the environment, but also our drainage management of our city.
What can we look ahead to 2014?
Well, we will continue our commitment to trying to educate the public about the importance of keeping our stormwater system as clean as possible. We will see emphasis on capital improvement projects like I just spoke. We are getting better and better about our management and our operation of the stormwater system. For 25, 30 years, there's literally been no funding stream to try to have the correct material and manning levels to address the stormwater problem. This is the first time that we've been able actually to dedicate funding to buying the appropriate kind of equipment and having the manpower to care for our stormwater system, keep it clean, keep it operationally functional, as well as there's now been an emphasis to keep in check any kind of development so that it doesn't make adverse impact on the stormwater system from the city. Examples of that, we have a large portion of our community developed. Every time a business comes in, they put up a big roof, they put in parking. That's just more water that is shed and not soaking into the ground. Used to be nobody worried about that water that was shed. Now for the last 10, 15 years, we've had engineering criteria in that when you develop, you'll have to have detainage or think about where that water is going to go to. Is it going to cause problems with your neighbors or somebody else down the river further? So now that when you drive around, you'll see the Walmarts and the shopping centers and new buildings have detention ponds out in front of their properties. That is because now we understand all that water that is shed, it takes time for it to go someplace, and that detention provides a storage so it doesn't flood your neighbor downstream. those kind of things.
Okay. Well, it's excellent information, and we can certainly see the impact in the quality of the water in the river.
I think we're making a big difference, and I think it'll continue to make a difference.
Okay. We look forward to more projects coming up in the future then.
All right.
Thanks for coming in. Howard Elstro, Lima's Public Works Director. I'm Ann Decker, and this is Community Focus on GTV2.
On this Tuesday morning, as always in this time period, we welcome representatives of the City of Lima and your phone calls at 224-1150. And don't wait around till the tail end of the half hour. We'll run out of time. So if you have some questions and the like this morning, we welcome Lima City Police Chief Kevin Martin to our WIMA studios. Good morning, Chief.
Good morning, Mike.
Yeah, again, if people have questions about law enforcement in the City of Lima, they need to call at 224-1150, and a rare chance to talk to the chief. Chief, right off the top, the federal government partial shutdown, has it affected your department at all?
Well, it has not had any direct effect on us. We did recently receive word that we have been awarded an additional COPS grant in order to hire a officer to create a school resource officer position within the city schools, and I'm not sure exactly at this point how that's going to impact the access to our funding.
Okay.
But fortunately, since there's a there's going to be a lag in terms of our being able to hire the officer and get the person trained, that sort of thing, that lag really it would take quite a while before it would have any direct impact on us.
All right. So as a general proposition, you're not seeing any trickle-down effect just yet regarding the partial federal government shutdown and your local municipal police operation, right?
No, we're not seeing anything at all at this point.
All right, that's a good thing, no doubt about it. Hey, I want to switch gears also, and again, our phone lines are open at 224-1150. Don't be timid. If you have a question for the chief, he's not going to bite. He'll just answer your question or your comment to the best of his ability. We're about a month now into the school year, maybe another week in addition to the month. And usually we think about the schools and obviously the increased pedestrian traffic around the schools. And I guess one of my pet peeves has always been the various pickup situations of the youngsters. And I understand that people are pretty hip. They want to make it convenient and be sure little Johnny and little Jane are safe when they pick them up from school. But a lot of times there's some abuse of that occasionally with street parking that's not appropriate and all of that. How has that gone at the various schools this year, Chief Martin, to the best of your knowledge?
Well, so far it's not been too bad. There is always that constant conflict between the parents and their need to get their kids dropped off and picked up from school, and the residents in the area that have to have access to their driveways and the streets in and around their home. And so our job with the police department and working with the schools are always very, very good about working with us on these things, is trying to find that balance that helps to adequately meet the needs of both interests.
Right.
And again, what we normally do when we have an increased number of complaints with any given schools, we will assign an officer to do problem solving and to try to come up with some creative solutions to hopefully be able to, again, find that balance between those competing needs.
But just because it's a let-out time at a school doesn't mean that one can completely ignore the no parking on this side of the street sign, can they?
No, and sometimes that is what the problem solving comes down to, is we have to have officers go through and just begin issuing parking tickets, which, again, is not something we want to do as a first resort because, again, we do empathize with the parents' positions. But if it's creating a traffic hazard and we have no other recourse, then sometimes that is what we have to resort to.
All right. Generally, it's been good so far. There was an interesting development here, I guess, a week or so ago at Lima Senior. A couple of local fellows were pastors at a local church that were looking out for some of the kids as they were making their way from school. If you will, you can call it a solicitation of sorts, but all for the good, not questioning their motives by any means. What is Lima Police Department take on that sort of activity?
Well, we greatly appreciate any time citizens are willing to get involved in a situation like this. And again, they did it in the right way. It was in a peaceful, non-confrontational way. But at the same time, their being out there helps to calm the effect. Sometimes when you have the police go into a situation where you have the large crowds, and it actually can help to increase the intensity of the situation, if you will. And so in a situation like this, getting the local pastors involved, I see that as a very good thing. And we greatly appreciate their efforts. We greatly appreciate their willingness to give their time and literally of themselves in order to be able to help solve these problems. And again, because our goal is not to see how many young people we can arrest. Our goal is to make sure everyone gets home safely, nobody gets hurt. And the pastors just went a long way. And I, as I understand, it was not just pastors, but the men that got out there got involved. Yes, the people that got involved in that, I think, provided a great service.
All right, excellent. With Chief Kevin Martin of the Lima Police Department, our in-studio guest. Phone lines are open at 224-1150. It's 814. It's 8:18 from News Talk 1150 WIMA. Tuesday morning with representatives of the city of Lima. Today, Lima Police Chief Kevin Martin is our in-studio guest. 224-1150. Questions or comments regarding law enforcement, city of Lima. Everybody's happy, loving the job that you guys are doing, Chief Martin. No calls so far. Either that or they're just not they're not prepared to challenge you in any manner. So what are you going to do? Right, you're just gonna keep your head down and move ahead, right?
Well, I certainly hope people are happy with the job that the Lima Police Department is doing.
Absolutely, and of course the phones are open 24 hours when it comes to the Lima Police Department. And we've had this conversation before, but there are no shortage of calls that you folks get on a regular basis, right?
Oh no, it's we average in a given year. Normally between about 40 and 45,000 calls for service per year.
All right. Interesting development here just a little while back, the closing of one of the ambulance services in town, which narrows it really now to two services and really hasn't had any problems in terms of a not sufficient ambulance service as far as you know?
No, actually, the remaining ambulance company and the Lima Fire Department have both stepped up. And I know it's been a strain on their staffing levels, but they have stepped up and filled the void. And actually, again, my hat's off to them because they've done an excellent job in keeping up with the increased call load.
How about crime in general? Are there any recent numbers or any semi-official designations that you can point to how things are trending for the city?
Well, recently I had the privilege of participating in a League of Women Voters panel forum. And in that forum, a question came up as to, you know, how do we measure the effectiveness of the job that we're doing? And I spoke about the crime numbers. And so I actually went back to 2008. And I picked 2008 because there were actually two very significant things that happened in 2009. The first one was with the election of Sheriff Sam Krish, the PACE unit for the Lima Police Department was combined with the West Central Ohio Crime Task Force, and there was just a lot of increased cooperation between various law enforcement agencies.
Sort of a merging of the resources and stuff.
Yes, indeed. Yeah. And then with the also with 2009 was also the implementation of the pinpoint policing that the Lima Police Department undertakes with looking for the high crime or hot spots areas within the city and trying to target on those areas in order to be able to prevent crime.
Areas that have been proven to be known more so by just hard statistical numbers as higher crime areas, right?
Yes, indeed. And in looking at that trending from 2008 through the end of 2012, we saw more than a 20% drop in the crime numbers during that period of time. And then also, at the same time, I look at the most recent UCR numbers that we have for this year, which would be January 1 through August 31st. And I compared those with the exact same time period last year. And in comparing those, I found that there was almost an 11% decrease in crime for the first 8 months of 2000 and 2013 compared to 2012. So, again, things are continuing in the right direction. Mm-hmm. Obviously, I don't have a crystal ball, so I can't say what the final crime numbers will be at the end of the year. But at least so far, again, I think that it shows that the increased cooperation amongst law enforcement in Allen County and as well as the pinpoint policing concept, both appear to be working.
Sounds as though really a proactive approach with the pinpointing, as you suggest, really does matter. Is there a fear at any point in time that you maybe are showing less attention to areas that haven't been crime-ridden, or is it goes without saying that you're not ignoring those areas? You're just concentrating more heavily in certain day periods with targeted areas.
And that is exactly it, Mike, that we are increasing the amount of resource that we put into the hotspot areas, but we are not neglecting any area of the city. And also the pinpoint is only going to be as effective as the people within Lima are willing to report crime and activity that's happening.
Right.
Because, again, we need to know what's going on somewhere. And we know that we're not going to completely eliminate crime from the community.
Mm-hmm.
Oftentimes what we'll do when we focus our efforts into one area, it's going to shift some of that crime to other areas, and we need to know where it shifts to. So that's where, again, we really depend on the residents within this community and the business owners to let us know when crime happens at their location.
I was speaking with one of the local judges here last week, and the thoughts and the comments were generally that there just remains a frustration with the infusion of illegal narcotics that is at the root of so much of the criminal activity. It's been that way for a long, long time, and your experience indicates that's still largely the case, right?
Oh, yes, and I've heard a lot of different numbers as to what the actual percentage of crime is that's, again, either directly or indirectly related to illegal drugs.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not sure which of those numbers are true, but I can tell you anecdotally that a large amount of the crime that occurs is drug-related, and sometimes it may not be directly related to obtaining drugs, but it may be somebody that gets arrested for shoplifting because they have used their EBT card instead of buying groceries to trade it for crack cocaine, for instance.
Right.
And so then they go into the store to shoplift in order to be able to feed themselves.
All right. So it is quite clear. And, you know, and for me, that's always an argument you hear from a lot of folks that you need to lessen the enforcement effort against a drug usage. I contend that actually would probably elevate crime because with the consistent and ongoing drug usage, it's all the negative spinoffs of that with break-ins, with theft, and stuff like that that comes from that drug usage that people often forget, right?
Yes, and that's where, again, if we were to legalize drugs, my fear is that, again, the people will not quit becoming addicted to drugs. In fact, I think the amount of addiction will continue.
Explode.
And then someone will have to somehow pay for that addiction.
Right.
And again, it's probably going to continue to be through the other types of crime, thefts and robberies, things of that nature, for people to be able to support those habits.
Is there anything particularly focused on with the Lima Police in this October time of the year, a little bit of the changing seasons, or traditional things like curfews and that still remain for the youth, right?
Yes, indeed. And for anyone that wants to know the curfew times for the City of Lima, they are on the City of Lima's website, www.cityhall.lima.oh.us. And they can parents can go there and look it up for the respective age ranges for their children. But, yes, we do continue to see curfew problems, especially on the weekends this time of year because the weather's still warm enough that kids want to still get out and about. And the reason why we focus so much on curfew enforcement is because our philosophy is we would rather be able to get the kids off of the street on some low-level offense such as curfew rather than allowing them to be out there to where either they commit a more serious crime or what is more likely is that they become victimized as a result of some type of serious or violent crime.
You know, another big thing that I'm sure you guys deal with, and some people wouldn't call it that big of a deal, but nevertheless, those folks that elect to just cut through yards and the private property of others, that's probably a traditional a kind of a dilemma and an issue that you faced in a town the size of Lima. What would you tell people that are frustrated with that, with people cutting through their yards? Is there any? I mean, obviously, it'd be nice and say, "Hey, please don't do that," but at some point, it wears you out.
Yeah, and unfortunately, there's not really a lot that the police department can do on that, because again, if they're cutting through, by the time we would get an officer out there, the person's going to be long gone. And that is one of those things that's frustrating. If you can find out who the kid's parents are, if you think you can talk to them, that's certainly an option. Again, if you call us, and we will do what we can to help. But again, unfortunately, our options in a case like that are going to be very limited.
How about also the issue of parking? We're seeing vehicles in yards, and we see vehicles on occasion that are street parked for lengthy periods of time. Is there some formula to maybe occasionally pinpoint a vehicle if it isn't moved for like 2-3 weeks at a time and it's street parked? What's the story there?
Well, normally if someone calls in because they've had a car that's parked on the street for more than 48 hours, if they call the police department, we will send an officer out. And we will place a warning tag on that vehicle, also chalk the tires. And then if it's not moved again after the 48 hours is up, then in addition to issuing a parking ticket against the owner, we can also impound the vehicle, and we will do that.
Okay, so there is absolutely a formula to deal with that, apparently.
Yes, indeed. And that is normally handled on a complaint basis, because officers will not really be able to tell, as a general rule, whether a car has been moved from one day to the next. Now, when the snow starts falling, that becomes a different situation. It's easy to see whether a car has been moved if there's still snow pile up all around it, and it's being an obstruction to the plow. Then the officers, again, they've got visible evidence right there that they can act off of. But normally, for those types of situations, we're going to depend upon the neighbors to give us a call.
In lieu of any calls here this morning at 224-1150, only about a minute to go, how aggressive or focused is the Lima Police Department, Chief Martin, in terms of speeders around town on various roadways? There is some focus on that?
Yes, we do have regular speed enforcement. Again, we do have radar and laser both available to us. So those are technologies that we're able to use to target speeding. And we do, in fact, enforce, especially in the high traffic accident areas, we do enforce speeding. Mm-hmm. And also in high complaint areas. Wayne Street, for instance, is an area where we'll regularly get complaints from the residents. And so in response to those, we will from time to time run speed enforcement operations.
What would you tell those folks who are in a really bad habit of crawling through stop signs?
Well, again, that is an illegal activity. And if an officer sees it, they can issue a citation. Again, you are required to come to a complete stop, whether it's a four-way stop, two-way stop, does not matter. Even if you're sure that no traffic is coming the other way, you are still required to come to a complete stop.
Lima Police Chief Kevin Martin, our in-studio guest this morning. Sorry to say no one took advantage of the opportunity to ask you any questions, but let's face it, Chief, who wants to intentionally talk to the chief of police? It just doesn't work that way, does it?
Well, I hope to think, yeah, I'd like to think that at least some people out there like to talk to me.
There you go. Chief, thanks for coming in. As always, we appreciate your time. Have a great day.
Thank you, Mike.